This is Stu Grimson, the Grim Reaper. You're watching the Power Play Break, the place to talk about pucks.
Back here with Pete Weber on the Power Play Break. Pete, you're in Buffalo now, and you're doing the Bills. And this has always intrigued me, not even from a hockey sense, but from a coaching sense. Marv Levy brought him four times to the Super Bowl and came up short. How do you look at that? Do you look at that, like, there are people out there who will say, well, they didn't win the game and they're losers. But there's other guys who said four times in a row to get there is not an easy thing to do. I mean, how frustrating was that?
It was frustrating, really frustrating for the fans. And I don't know any more fervent group of football fans than those. As a matter of fact, in Nashville, when we're home on a Sunday, there's a group of Nashville Bills backers that gather at McNamara's Irish Pub, usually about 100 strong. And oftentimes I am among them when they do. And texting my old buddy John Murphy, who succeeded Van Miller as the play-by-play voice of the team. Yes, it was frustrating. When I think about that, though, I wonder if the infamous wide right against the Giants, had Scott Norwood made that kick and 47 yards on grass, was not a gimme by any stretch of the imagination, would the Bills ever have gone back again? Would it have taken the hunger away from them of trying to get back and win, as who was it? Dwayne Thomas talked about, it's the ultimate game. How do they play another one next year?
Yeah.
But that was a time where, yes, I think they could have and probably should have won that game against the Giants. And I also think the fourth Super Bowl, the second one against Dallas in Atlanta, is one they probably should have won too. But how can you? No one's ever going to do that again.
No, I can't imagine. It's impossible.
I can't imagine it. And of course, the salary cap era came after that, which would have made it much more difficult for Bill Polian and Marv Levy to put a group together like that. But I'm always going to remember that as an incredible golden era. Absolutely.
Was Marv frustrated? I mean, he seems more to me as an educator, not as a coach. I mean, like he seems in that vein. Today's coaches are always seem to be yelling and screaming. Marv, though, seemed to be more of an educational guy.
Well, I hosted Marv's radio show, and there was this one caller that would always call him Duke from the West Side, who would complain that he wasn't as emotional as a Mike Ditka, for example, on the sideline. But still at that time, we had Tom Landry in the league.
Yeah.
And you had mentioned Bill Walsh. I mean, Bill Walsh, certainly avuncular. And yeah, all coaches get mad at one time or another. It's the style in which they express it. And Marv always felt that if it looked as if he were losing control of himself, he might lose control of the team.
Mm-hmm.
And I can accept that fully.
So you're there now, and you're still doing the Sabres and everything.
Yes.
And you moved to the 90s, and you're still probably doing Buffalo Bills stuff and having a good time. Now expansion comes, and you probably want to make the move.
Yes. And I was lucky, because I prepared this way for it. The radio opening came on the Sabres, and I took that in 1995.
Okay.
So I had the last year at the Odd, the first year at the then new Marine Midland Arena, and it's gone through a couple of different names since, now First Niagara Center. So I think that's what prepared me for this step.
So you're going to come now to the Nashville Predators. Was this all the stuff you've done and we've discussed today?
Yeah.
You know, you've done all different things, much like a lot of people do in broadcasting in business. People have to kind of juggle at different times in their career.
I mean, Jim Gordon's remembered as what? The Giants and the Rangers play-by-play guy. But he was a great newsman on radio as well.
So were you excited to get this opportunity to come to Nashville? I mean, now you're going to be on a regular TV thing. You're going to be covering a team. Did you say to yourself, I mean, we talk on the show about how guys say my first NHL game and my first NHL goal were really special.
Yeah.
But now you're the face on TV for the Predators. I mean, how did that, was it exciting for you? Was it
very exciting for me. Now, the reason I went after it, my wife's family had migrated to Knoxville, Tennessee years before. And I said, hey, you know, there's these four new expansion franchises coming in over the years. Nashville, Atlanta, Columbus, which was my wife's hometown in Minnesota. But she said right away, why wait if there's a chance in Nashville? Let's go after this. So I did. In those great 1,200 baud modem days, I found that the founding owner, Craig Leopold, was in Racine, Wisconsin. And the next day after the provisional franchise was announced, I FedExed my stuff to him. And then I kept following up. Then a key thing happened. Jerry Helper, who I had known and worked with the Sabres, became the communications director for the Nashville Predators. I'd also had some familiarity with Jack Diller, who was the president of the franchise and had been at the Garden. So those first efforts were sent out in the summer of 97. The team was going to begin play in the fall of 98. We're visiting my in-laws around 4th of July in Knoxville, and we just borrow the car and drive over to Nashville and meet with the people, and several weeks later I was signed up.
So now you're going to take this job. How has hockey been the first like couple of years down there? Was it a novelty? Was it more of like, oh, we have a professional franchise now in Nashville. We're big time. Any city that gets a professional sports franchise becomes big time all of a sudden.
And simultaneously, they got the football team. The Houston Oilers had moved there, and while in 1997 they played their games at the Liberty Bowl in Memphis, they moved to Nashville in 98. The Predators were supposed to start in 99, but Craig Leopold was petitioning the NHL saying, hey, we can't give them that much lead time on us to try to establish the first two professional sports teams in the city. So that's what happened. And yes, the city had minor league hockey going back to the early 1960s with the old Dixie
Flyers. Well,
the
Devils were rumored to go there too
in
95.
Now, and see, I was traveling to Nashville on a regular basis doing baseball in the summer times. And when I was in Nashville at one point in 95, it seemed like that really was going to happen. Now, I do know one thing. Had it happened in the Bible Belt, they would not have been known as the Nashville Devils.
No.
That was not going to happen. And everybody's going to have a 666 logo on their sleeves or anything like that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, and then you know what also happened in the interim, Chris? It looked like the Edmonton Oilers might move there in 96 until they got saved by local ownership. So it would have been two teams named Oilers moving to the same city virtually simultaneously.
Good sports trivia question for the TV. Those early days, though, must have been exciting to be there with the expansion franchise.
Yes.
You know, just to be down there, have fun.
Teaching hockey 101 courses. I'd say before two-thirds of the home games in the meeting rooms of the arena. And one night, I really set it up great for the fans. They had no idea, but when I was with the Kings, Stevie Carlson was one of our players. The Hanson brothers.
Of the Hanson brother fame, yes.
So the Hanson brothers were coming in, making an appearance for Bud Light. They were going to do the old Zamboni behind, or the ski behind the Zamboni bit. So they came bursting into the classroom doors, kind of like what happened at the end of Blazing Saddles of the cafeteria on the movie lot, if you recall.
Yeah.
And that was, the class paid rapt attention to what we were saying that particular evening.
Now, Barry Trotz is still their coach.
Yes.
And still down there. He's been since the inception. How has he been able to survive so long, in your opinion, down there? I mean, coaches come and go in the NHL. This year there's been a lot of firings already.
I think since Barry Trotz was named the coach, there's been like 170 coaching changes in the league since going back to 1998. So, yeah, it's. I think everybody probably should have interim attached to the job title. But the reason is the continuity established by general manager David Poile. David was general manager for a long time in Washington before he came to Nashville. And he didn't exactly juggle coaches there either. Once he exchanged Terry for Brian Murray, so brothers there, and see, Trotsky's lucky, he doesn't have any brothers, the way that works out. But Barry has been a solid presence there. All the players know what's expected. And really, in most terms, in the other days in sports, teams and players didn't change that much.
No.
Because of turnover, he's pretty much had a fresh slate of players to deal with virtually every year.
Now, you have a mini celebrity in a sense with Mike Fisher.
Yes.
And his lovely wife. How has that helped the franchise down there?
You know, I think what it has done, he always wanted to reach out to the country music community. From the outset, we have had Vince Gill and Amy Grant, husband and wife, as season ticket holders. Also, Barbara Mandrell and her family. Barbara, a hockey mom.
Yes.
So our first few weeks in Nashville, she and her family had the entire team, front office staff, out at their house for a big party.
Oh, wow.
And we have stayed close with Barbara ever since. She'll call my brother on his birthday or whatever. And that sort of big, small town atmosphere is what has prevailed. And now the country music community, but not only the country music, I mean, and I think we saw recently at the Hockey Hall of Fame ceremonies, you get guys like Kid Rock coming around, and Kid Rock records a lot in Nashville. Neil Young records a lot in Nashville. One night, we do surprises on the bandstand in the intermissions where we have performing groups. And one night, it was Vince Gill with Alice Cooper.
Oh.
And not announced, just showed up
yeah.
and did it.
Now, was it a tough sell in the beginning? Well, people were, we've got two professional franchises, one in football, one in hockey. I mean, was it a tough sell?
It wasn't tough other than this. It's 8 football games to buy. It's 41 hockey games to buy. So that's where they immediately marketed and moved into the mini season plans, the 6 to 12 to half season to full season plans. So in the first 2 years, sellouts were regular. Then it became more difficult. And then in 07, it looked like the team was going to be moved.
Yes.
And got through that. Local ownership came on. And the last few years, I'm going to say the last... And, let's throw away, but though that was a great year for sellouts, the truncated season of the lockout this last year, the crowds have been pretty full.
What has been the best part for you being down there as the voice on the TV side for the Predators?
The most difficult part is going shopping at Home Depot for a new toilet seat and being asked all sorts of hockey questions. But no, that has been so much fun. I can walk into a store, and I have to be very careful now. If I ask for something, somebody will go, oh, I recognize that voice doing that. But that's been a lot of fun, Chris. It really has. There's been no downside to it.
When we get back, we're going to have some fun with Pete right after this.